Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
I have decided.
Deciding to follow Jesus is a wonderful thing. It leads to a lot of change, and one of the changes that it leads to is it gives us a servant's heart. For as we follow the one who came to serve us, we learn from his example that God would have us serve others. You know, as I'm looking at what's coming up this week, realizing that Vacation Bible School, it starts on Monday, I'm very impressed with the people who followed Jesus. I realize that we're not just going to have over 200 kids, but we're going to have about 60 people who are serving this week, saying, I want to show love so that someone can know Christ. I see examples of people who are following Jesus. And yeah, I'm very aware that serving Jesus isn't something that specifically and only takes place in a building like this. It takes place during the week. It takes place as we are showing the love of God. And as we follow him, we do become servants. Thank you. Thank you for serving God Almighty, and I hope that the combination of doing that with the people of Treasure Lake Church, that it would be very encouraging. In fact, I think that we can look around and we can learn from each other. There is a servant, and I would like to be like them. I'm so glad that we get a chance to spend some time together today, that we're going to sing praises to our great King, that we're going to study his word, and we're going to find ourselves saying, Lord, we want to be great followers. And as we pray, there's many a person that we want to be praying for. I'd like to bring to your attention that come Thursday, Dan Quinn has a significant surgery that they'll be working to help his heart function better. And so we're praying for him with an upcoming surgery on Thursday. Praying for Beb Flanders, who has an injured foot and needs to be able to get around. And there's been some other complications as well. We're asking for their strength. We're praising God that Luke's moving through sergeant school has been going very well. Praying that God would bring healing and health to Beth and Steve, Jim and Bernie, Brad, John and Denise, Bill Wright's brother, Diane Lowe, Aunt Betty, Bud, Alex's mother. Asking that the Lord would give strength and added confidence, good days to Lana and Ernie and Julie. And praying that the Lord God Almighty will work greatly through Vacation Bible School this week. It is a wonderful occasion. Would you please pray every day that the gospel is heard, that the love of Jesus is felt, that hearts are touched, and that confidence and faith is placed in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What a great thing to start life early, knowing the one who loves you most. Let's pray. Father God, you are gracious and good to us, full of loving kindness. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that great things have come to us this week. Your hand has been good. We thank you that you've prepared good things for us this following week. And we thank you that there is this place in your kingdom to serve. And we thank you for the many hands that serve both in this facility and outside to people who need to know Jesus and feel his love. Father, make us to be great servants of you. And we pray that our lives would be modeled after the one who we call Savior and Lord. God, work in us and make us happy servants who are serving you with a full heart. God, with a big week of Vacation Bible School right upon us, we pray that all things would go well. We pray that those kids would show up and have a super good time. We pray, Father, that you would help each classroom and each event to go off well. And we pray, Father, that great truths would be taught and that you would touch hearts and that the love of Jesus would be made known. I pray, Father, that there would be momentum that builds each and every day. I pray that entire families are touched because of this. May little ones place their faith in you, and may they know you as Savior and King. Father, we pray that you would heal Beth and Steve and Eleanor and Jim, John and Brad and Bernie. We pray that Diane will continue to recover, that Aunt Betty will get stronger. We pray for Bud and Alex's mother. Father, we pray that you would take away the cancer that they feel. We pray for Dan this Thursday, that the surgery would go extremely well and that he would recover quickly. Lord God, we ask that you would bless Bev Flanders, that she would get stronger along with Lana and Julie and Ernie and Janet. Thank you so much for them. Thank you for Luke as well. We pray that he finishes sergeant school with grace. Father God, we pray that you would lead us to the right person who would be our worship director. And Father God, we pray that we would love you with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind. Make us students of your word and people who love your community very much. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, our precious Lord and Savior. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Hey, church family, it's here. Vacation Bible School begins Monday morning. We have been planning, preparing, and praying for this day. We thank the Lord that over 200 children are registered and over 50 volunteers are ready to go. Would you please continue to pray? Pray that these wonderful children will connect with the heart of God. Pray that the gospel will be clearly communicated. Pray that the large cast of players making VBS happen will excel in loving the children. Pray that this experience will touch entire families. God brings good things to his children, and VBS is one of them. Thank you for praying, and keep an eye on our TLC Facebook page for updates. Are you looking for something that will be a great highlight for the summer? How about Del Grosso's? Boy, does that look like fun. The kids love it. What could be better than sun, water, and sliding down a hill? Well, I can answer that. How about Del Grosso's? That's right. We're heading for Del Grosso's on August 12th for a day of rides and water fun. And here's what's so special. When we say that there's an educational discount, we mean discount. Instead of paying $36 a person, how about $20? That makes a big difference on the checkbook. So don't miss out. This special comes once a year. Sign up soon and be part of the fun. Tuesday, August 1st will be our blood drive. Come and give the gift that saves lives. Your donation will bless someone right here in our community. The blood drive runs from 1 to 6 p.m. Saturday, August 5th, God is going to be blessing many at the Awaken concert. That's 5 to 10 p.m. at the American Legion stage in Brockway. We are going to praise the Lord with great Christian musicians. It will be awesome. If you're tuning into these announcements, there's a good chance that you love Jesus. He is the Lord of all and the Savior of those who put their trust in him. As we follow Jesus, we seek to do everything that he asks. One of those things is to identify with him through baptism.
On August 13th, we're going to be having a baptism service.
That'll be at New Providence Beach for an all-church picnic, and after we eat, we'll be baptizing those who want to publicly identify as Jesus's followers. If you're interested in being baptized, please reach out to Pastor Dave. We are mobilizing for the big event at the end of August. The Churches of Dubois come together for Family Day at the Park and Church at the Park, August 26th and 27th. We have the opportunity to bless this community by providing a free extravaganza for families right here in the heart of Dubois. It takes an army to pull this one off, and you are needed. We have sign-up sheets at the welcome desk. Could you invest an hour or two by helping kids have a great time in the bounce house or obstacle course? If so, would you please sign up for Kids Games? Can you flip a lot of burgers or hand out free meals with a smile? If so, would you sign up for the food team? Can you help our bands provide CDs and t-shirts for those who love their music? If so, sign up for the merchandising team. The point of all of this is that Jesus will be lifted up in Dubois, and the body of Christ will express unity and love. It'll be a great time. If this is your first time with us, thanks for being here. We welcome you. Please find the welcome card in the pew in front of you, fill it out, and leave it in the basket by the sanctuary doors on your way out.
I suppose that we've become a bit accustomed to being rather harsh on the topic of fatigue. We sort of want to dispel of any trace of it. We don't want it to touch our life. We want to keep fatigue as far away from us as possible. And we are developing a very lopsided view of fatigue. And I bumped into a couple quotes this week, which I think might help us put a different spin on fatigue. Thomas Paine was one of the great primary thinkers which stood behind the fact that this country decided to declare its independence. And what Thomas Paine said was this. He said, "Those who expect to reap the blessings of freedom must, like men, undergo the fatigue of supporting it." Yes, Thomas Paine believed in freedom. Yes, he wanted to live that way. And yes, he anticipated that if we are to maintain this freedom for which we are fighting, later on it is going to come with a price, and the price is that we will experience fatigue. And here's the principle. You see, grand pursuits will generate fatigue. And the energy that's required to maintain that freedom, it will be worthwhile. But one of the logical consequences of fulfilling the goal of having freedom is we will endure the fatigue of maintaining that freedom. Morgan Freeman had something interesting to say on the subject. He said, "Fatigue, discomfort, and discouragement are merely symptoms of effort." So in other words, if we successfully avoid fatigue and all discomfort, it is likely that we have also ventured to accomplish very, very little. And therefore, both men are making this suggestion that fatigue accompanies that which is worthwhile. It is not to always be avoided, nor is it to be sought after, but it will coincide with noble pursuits. And today, as we turn to our text in Acts chapter 20, we'll be looking at one of the more famous stories about fatigue in Scripture. And we begin reading that story in verse 1, which says this. "When the uproar had ended, Paul sent for the disciples, and after encouraging them, said goodbye and set out for Macedonia." Now, we discussed this huge uproar last week. It took place in this massive theater, and there people for hours and hours chanted, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians," and there was a riot that took place which totally changed Paul's timetable for his departure from Ephesus. He was planning on leaving one day, and now he needed to leave ASAP, and so he departs. And as he departs, where is it that Paul goes? Luke would like to share that information with us. He left Ephesus and he headed back up north to the area of Macedonia. There he had planted churches in Philippi and Thessalonica and Berea. He had friends there. And Luke gives a description of what takes place while he is on this trip up in Macedonia. And he traveled through that area speaking many words of encouragement to the people and finally arriving in Greece. Well, those words give us both his travel direction and his primary task. His task, it says, he was sharing, speaking many words of encouragement. I think that this is the purpose of Paul's trip. In my mind, he felt rather responsible for the spiritual lives of those people where he had planted the churches. And he was thinking, you know, I'm facing persecution all the time. It's kind of rough out here. I wonder how they're doing. Because they're probably getting hammered as well. Paul was aware that there were false teachers that were coming who were distracting people from true faith in Jesus, and he wanted their faith to stay pure. And so Paul thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to hit the road. I'm going to go back there. I'm going to talk with them, and I'm going to bring words of encouragement to them. And I'm sure the people would have been happy for Paul to show up because he was a master teacher. And couldn't you imagine if you had built up questions over the years since Paul had been there, the great opportunity to say, Paul, can you help me with this one? And he would have been there to help them, and he was there to bring words of encouragement. I think the tone of what Luke wrote is actually he brought words of exhortation. Exhortation, it's a wonderful term. Exhortation is to encourage people to pursue a specific goal, to say, hey, you know what? Together with Jesus, we can do this. Do you know what? By God's strength and by God's power, he said that this is true, and you and I can live this way. So come on, let's trust Jesus, and let's see what happens as he lives through us. He showed up, and he was involved in exhorting and encouraging these people that he loved. And his destination, moving down from Macedonia, would take him all the way into Greece. And as he arrived in Greece, he would be visiting other groups of people and churches that he had planted. And the description of his getting down in Greece is captured in the next verse that says, and he stayed 3 months. Because some Jews had plotted against him just as he was about to sail for Syria, he decided to go back through Macedonia. First, it tells us how long he stayed in Greece, and there are many scholars who believe that that amazing, wonderful book of Romans was actually written during these 3 months as he found himself in Corinth again. The book of Romans, many believe to be the richest piece of theology that we had in Scripture, and so Paul was incredibly active communicating not just to the people that were there, but also speaking to people that he hadn't seen yet because he has a great calling from God to love and to minister to people. But Paul's timetable there is going to change as well, and what we read is this. You see, while he stayed there for 3 months because some Jews plotted against him just as he was about to sail for Syria, he decided to go back through Macedonia. Well, he had a plan. And his plan had been that he was going to take a bit of a sailing trip. He was going to be leaving down there from the area around Greece. He was going to be sailing all the way to Syria, but he did not do that because it came to his attention that there was a group of people who either in the port or on that boat were going to terminate his life. And so Paul made an audible and he said, well, I'm going to head back overland, a very long hike, all the way back up through Macedonia, because people are trying to eliminate me. And Luke goes on and says at this time that there were 7 people that accompanied him on this trip. Why so many? Was it because Paul needed protection? I don't know, but Luke lists their name. And he, Paul, was accompanied by Sopater, son of Phirhus, and from Berea, Aristarchus and Secundus from Thessalonica, Gaius from Derbe, Timothy also, and Tychius and Prometheus from the province of Asia. Now, I don't know why these people ended up traveling a little bit ahead of Paul, and these men went on ahead and they waited for us at Troas, but we sailed from Philippi after the festival of unleavened bread, and 7 days later, we joined others in Troas, and there we stayed for 7 days. Well, Paul is sailing to a wonderful place called Troas. And as he is making that journey to Troas, he is crossing again across the Dardanelles Straits that he had crossed many years before when he first brought the gospel to Europe. And much had changed during those years. I have a feeling that as he set sail, with great satisfaction, he could have been thinking about the fact that now there were churches that existed from Philippi in the north all the way to Corinth in the south. That spans 730 miles, about the distance between Dubois and Atlanta. And God Almighty had been bringing the truth of Jesus to this whole huge area in Europe, and people had come to Christ. And things were changing, and Paul would have had a sense of satisfaction. But we should ask ourselves a question as we have now looked at these first six verses, and the question is this: why is it that Luke tells us about Paul's travel in this level of detail? Why didn't he tell us the stories of what took place when Paul stopped in each location? He doesn't. He just tells us that Paul is moving through these locations, and I think the reason why Luke tells us this is he wants us to know that Paul believed that it was very important for him to go back and see these people again, because they were precious to him, because their faith and maturity was important, because their witness really mattered. And what Luke is demonstrating in these verses is this. He is saying, you know what? Paul loved God's people, and he prioritized their growth and their well-being. And so he was willing to take this long trip, which would have been a very long trip. The people that he had prayed for, the people that he had longed to see, were the people that he said, I'm going to show up and I'm going to see you. And we learned something about Paul's heart, the heart of someone who loves those believers that he's met and that he has yet to meet. I think that Paul's heart is captured well in the book of Romans, which he probably wrote just before he started back up to Macedonia. When he said these words, I think it captured what drove him. Paul said to believers in the city of Rome that he had not yet met, I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. This was the passion and the affection that Paul had. This expressed the care and concern. When he showed up, he wanted to do something, to offer something, to make some contribution, so that people's walk with Jesus would be stronger, so that their lives would be blessed. And he showed up intending to be a blessing. And my guess is that you might have met some people like that, because it's not just apostles who end up walking around saying, I long to make a contribution to your walk with Jesus. My guess would be this. Some of your favorite people in life are those people who have adopted this attitude. Lord, let me be a blessing to others and help other people along their walk. I pray that you enable me to make a contribution to them. And that's what Paul was doing as he was traveling all across the seaboard there on the western side of the Adriatic. Paul showed up. I think that I learned the importance of showing up during years that my family was living in Budapest. At that time, there were a group of people that I had various responsibilities from, and they were rather dispersed. From the north of St. Peter's, Russia, all the way down to the southern coast of Albania. From Slovenia, the home of Luka Doncic, who plays for the Mavs, all the way over to Siberia and beyond into Vladivostok. There were people that I was responsible to encourage and to help. And what I learned about my job during that time was this, that if I sat in Budapest and tried to dream how to help those people, I could never dream the right dream. In fact, the way that I knew how to fulfill my job the best was to go and to visit those people, because when I walked into their homes, when I saw what they were doing in their cities, when I saw the challenges that they were confronted by and what was disappointing them, all of a sudden I could make a long list of ways that I could serve and help them and get them resources. You see, showing up is one of those things that helps us to really minister to people. So Paul decided that he would show up. He showed up despite the fact that there were no planes and airports to speed his travel around. He showed up saying, if it takes me months, it's worth months because you are so worthwhile to me. And so Paul showed up asking the question, what can I do for you and how can I help you walk the walk with Jesus? Yeah, I'm convinced of this. It doesn't take an apostle to ask that question. And as we ask that question, I believe that God will teach us how we can help people in their walks with Jesus, and he will work through us. Well, Paul has sailed back across the Dardanelle Straits, and he enters into the city of Troas. It is a significant Roman city founded by Alexander the Great. In its heyday, the city had more than 100,000 people. It was a huge hub, not as big as Ephesus, but it was significant. And while he's there, we have this record of what takes place. And on the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. And Paul spoke to the people. And because he intended to leave the next day, kept on talking until midnight. Now, there are several things that I think are worthy to note about this passage. And the first is this, is that Paul is not doing exactly the same routine that he did in the past. When he would show up into an area and he didn't really know if there were believers there or not, he always went to the synagogue on a Saturday. And the reason why he would go to a synagogue on the Saturday was this. The Saturday was the day of worship for the Jewish people. And he knew that there would be a lot of people that he could connect with here. But as he goes to Troas, there is already a group of people who are there. And what's interesting is we find that they have already moved their day of worship, for they are gathering for the Lord's Supper, not on the last day of the week, but the text says on the first day of the week. And one could ponder, why in the world would that happen? And I think the reason probably is this. You see, when you talk about days that have great significance, well, the Sabbath was an amazing day after God had created so many things. He rested, and he said that day is a special day, but boy, Jesus came. And he rose again from the dead, and the very last enemy of mankind was defeated, and it was a day so worthy of celebration that apparently in Troas, they decided that they would worship on that day, and Paul joins them on a day that they gather together. And as Paul joins them, he shares with them a message, and the most noteworthy element of that message that transfers across history is this. It was a really, really long message. I think we know why it was a really long message. The text communicates that the following day he's planning on leaving, and Paul has a lot to say. He thinks that this might be the very last time he has a chance to speak to these people, and the reason is this, as he travels, well, there's riots and there's imprisonments and there's beatings. And Paul doesn't know if he's going to be around for another year, doesn't know if he's going to be around for another month. And he's had so much that he's communicated to other believers, he's trying to pack it all in on one occasion because he wants them to grow and to grow strong. And so as he is sharing final words with the people there in Troas, Luke records this, and there were many lamps in the upstairs room where they were meeting. Well, this is a late night meeting now, and because this is before electricity and light bulbs, obviously the room is going to be lit by flame, and the type of flame that Luke actually refers to is not so much lamps, but it is there were many torches in the room. Now, torches are pretty helpful for casting light, but they also cast a lot of smoke, and I think that this is sort of what we need to picture. This is the first day of the week, Sunday, and we would be making a mistake to think that was a weekend. Weekends didn't show up for a very long period of time. This was a work day, and this is after work that a group of people show up. They have already put in long hours to their jobs. They are tired. They have worked long. It is late at night. The lamps are generating all sorts of smoke. And apparently, I think that would be a situation that would promote the atmosphere of getting drowsy because the oxygen in the room is probably beginning to decrease. And as the hours get long, people are going to get tired. And that brings us to the story, one of the most famous stories of fatigue that we have in Scripture. And seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on. And when he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story and was picked up dead. Well, I find this to be a very intriguing story. I find it to be intriguing that here in Scripture, we have a story of someone who falls asleep while a preacher is trying to communicate God's truth. And I find this to be very refreshing because the Bible just covers all of the real elements of human life. And that real element of human life, of fatigue, it was hitting Eutychus really hard. So what do I think about this guy by the name of Eutychus? Well, I like Eutychus a lot because, do you know what happened was Eutychus came. He came to that meeting. I mean, he had probably put in a full day's work. It required effort for him to go, but he's going, and I think he's going in part because the reputation of Paul preceded him. This was a master teacher. He didn't want to lose out, and so Eutychus showed up. He had drive and interest to be there, and as he had entered the room and stayed a while, how long? Was it 3 hours? Was it longer than 3 hours? Well, the fatigue of his day was starting to catch up to him, and perhaps because of the heat of the Mediterranean climate, Eutychus decided that the best seat in the house would be a windowsill where maybe he would feel a little bit of the cool air and maybe he would get a little bit fresher air than that air which was being affected by the torches burning in the room. And the sad truth is that he sat down in a place that would be a nasty fall for 3 stories high with cobblestones below would be a very unforgiving drop. And there as he sat, his head bobbed, and he found his eyes getting heavy. He began to sink deeper and deeper into his position. One of his shoulders shifted just a little bit, and at that moment it was enough, and Eutychus plummeted over the edge and out of sight. And it was incredibly understandable that this would happen to someone who is so very tired. Now, I think it's clear, had Eutychus never sat on that ledge, we never would have heard about him. He isn't the first person who fell asleep while Paul was speaking, but he is the most dramatic person who fell asleep while Paul was sleeping. And all of a sudden, the room gasps as he disappears from view. He lets out a yelp, and Eutychus's mom, I think, would sort of like to show up and say, hey, couldn't we say a few other things about Eutychus beyond that? I mean, he's a really great guy, and he was kind, and he loved the Lord. But history, all it tells us is that Eutychus dropped out of sight, and he plummeted to the stones below, and it was a tough moment for that community. I'd like to pause here for a little bit, because the story does go on, and it has a very extraordinary ending that we will get to. But I find it to be very convenient that here we have in Scripture a text which is commenting on, well, people who fall asleep during parts of a worship service. I find it to be very helpful and convenient that Scripture mentions this because this is a phenomena which has taken place across all of the church's history, across all of the continents, and yes, it is something that takes place here at Treasure Lake Church as well. And I suppose that a lot of people would sort of like to know, so Dave, what do you think about this phenomena of people who nod off while they are at church? Well, I do have some thoughts, and I feel really good about sharing them with you. My thoughts are these. First, I have done that myself. Dozed off, I found Sherry ribbing me in a service. This very well could be a picture of Dave on a given Sunday attempting to listen to someone who is prepared for us to hear God's truth. And so it is not uncommon for me to find myself fighting with sleep as well. And it is such a common theme that it has entered into our humor system as we have various sketches of people who are nodding off in a church service. I particularly find Mr. Bean to be rather funny. And some might have a feeling that, you know, if you're nodding off in church, boy, that's a real significant foul. It's a real sign of disrespect. You shouldn't do that. And I want you to know that I don't see things that way at all. That is not my perspective of what happens when someone nods off in church. You see, I remember nodding off in a lot of different venues. I remember late afternoons at school. I remember early morning classes in college, particularly after I had been studying late the evening before. Those were places where it was very difficult for me to keep my eyes open. And I'm aware of this, that today there are some really, really good medications that have some pretty strong side effects. And sometimes one of those side effects is being drowsy. And so my view is this: I actually expect for people to be nodding off during the services that we have here at TLC. And what I've learned is this: is some of the nicest people in the world can snooze right through what I consider to be the most passionate and important point that I wanted to share that day. And my view is that, you know, I expect for that to happen. I have never, nor will I, scold anyone. And the reason is this: you see, there are so many other things that are far, far more important than nodding off at church. For instance, coming and being part of this community is it's more important. Because you see, when you show up here and when you walk into the entryway and you see these people that you know and you connect with them and you encourage them and you find out what's going on so that we are people who know each other, and then when you come in here and you hear someone share a prayer request and you decide that you're going to be praying for that person during the week, and when you end up tracking with people and they understand that somebody here loves them and cares about them, I just want you to know that those things would never happen if you didn't come here. And coming here and having this connection, well, that is, I believe, more important than nodding off from time to time while a message is being shared. So there are some things that are more important than nodding off during a service, and I hope that you will lighten up on yourself if that happens. Some things are more important, for instance, identifying with a Christian community and saying, well, the people who are here, they're actually my brothers and sisters in Christ, and God Almighty has brought us together, and I have a contribution to make to them, and they're going to be sharing with me, and we can spur each other on in this life, and we can grow together by God's grace. Boy, that perspective of identifying with each other and doing life together, I consider that to be more important than dozing off from time to time in the middle of a sermon. So if that happens to you, would you please lighten up on yourself? Now, I realize that I might need to balance what I'm saying a little bit, because let's suppose that the reason why you are dozing off often is on the previous evening you have a habit of staying up until the wee hours of the morning watching movies. At that point, I think somewhere in your soul, there's a voice that if you tune in, you're going to hear it. You're going to hear that voice say, you know, there are some things that are more important than watching movies to all hours of the evening. I think there are, and wisdom tells us that. But here is something that I believe is true and is very important. You see, as we find ourselves facing fatigue, there is plenty of fatigue that I would classify as noble fatigue. And noble fatigue is we are tired because we have done something which is valuable. We are tired because we have found ourselves serving others and serving the Lord. We are tired because we are not only bearing our own burdens, but we are bearing the burdens of others. And there are many people here at TLC who show up to our gatherings and they feel the effects of noble fatigue. And I do not equate noble fatigue with any sense of shame whatsoever. And any sorts of fatigue can cause you to nod off during a service. So I want you to know that I feel your pain. I want you to know that I consider one of my tasks to be working in this area of pain. You see, the illustrations and the pictures and the historical details there, they're not something that's generated by some sort of random chance happening. They are there in part because I know the pain of sitting in the pew. I know the pain of trying to track with something that I understand is important, but I lose the thread of what's going on and I find myself nodding off. I know that pain, and so I attempt to join with you by trying to create in this time some of the most interesting minutes that we're going to have all week long. It's one of my goals, but I also know this, that there are some side effects of some medication that are so strong that given my best shot, it still isn't going to be enough to overcome that sort of fatigue. And when that happens, I'd just like to say, please lighten up on yourself, because there are some things that are far more important than dozing off in church. Now, you may say, it sounds kind of strange. I'm listening to my pastor saying that it's not much of a big deal to have a snooze in church. Did I hear that right? And what I'd like to say is, yeah, that's right. You see, that's not the most important thing. There are some other things that are so much more important. So let's cover that. If snoozing in church isn't a big problem, well, what is a big problem? Well, the big problem would be not caring at all that God has spoken to us so that we ignore what he has written in his word. You see, when we don't care about God's word that God wants to coach us up, we find ourselves living in a self-inflicted wound whereby we maim what God is trying to create in our lives. Not caring that God's spoken, oh, that is a serious problem. And also believing that what God has written isn't pertinent to our lives, that's a significant problem. You see, when we think that what God has written isn't pertinent, we usually find ourselves judging what God has written, and we sort of want to say, God, since you know all things, why don't you say things that are more important? Why don't you tell us how we can have a better life and accomplish our dreams? I don't want to hear what you have to say. That would be a significant problem, and a problem would be thinking that we really don't need each other because we absolutely do. And so the application based on what's really important, I think, is this. Care enough to come so that you can connect and love and see what God will do through many people. I think the application is treat God's word as if it's valuable, and if this isn't the best venue for you, find perhaps that sitting and reading his word on your porch is what is going to do it for you the most. And don't stop building relationships here just because you're afraid that you might have your eyes closed and see dark for a little bit. Don't let that stop you. For you see, when we major on the minors, we often lose what is really important. If we major on, I certainly wouldn't want to go to a place where I might fall asleep because I find it to be embarrassing. That is a small thing. That is minor. But what is major is we are to love Jesus and trust Jesus and serve Jesus. And with that said, I think it's time for us to return to Eutychus, the poor guy who tumbles off the windowsill and goes down and hits the street below. It was a severe fall, and it was a fall that resulted in Eutychus not making it. And as people go down and see how Eutychus is doing, there are cries that are rising, and there are people who are in pain because the unthinkable has just happened, but God was not done with Eutychus. You see, this is what happened, and Paul went down. He threw himself on the young man, put his arms around him. Don't be alarmed, he said. He is alive. And he went upstairs again, broke bread and ate, and after talking until daylight, he left, and the people took the young man home alive, and they were greatly comforted. You see, God can do all things. And God had plans for Eutychus, and God, by his power, repaired the injuries that were fatal. This is a great example of the power of God. Now, how is it that Paul knew that God had plans for Eutychus and that he should come back to life? I don't know the answer to that question. I do know the answer that apparently that doesn't seem to be God's plan all the time, because obviously Eutychus is no longer with us as some sort of timeless person. But on this occasion, he is healed. His family was thrilled. The people in Troas were thrilled. And people went back upstairs and said, let's continue what we started. Let's study God's word and let's enjoy time together. And they pulled an all-nighter. They pulled an all-nighter until with the rising of the sun and the following moment, Paul understood that he had a ship that was departing. He had spoken to them everything that he had on his heart that could fit in that time frame. It was an evening that no one would ever forget, because Eutychus fell out the window and he was brought back to life. And I am convinced of this, that many people on that evening, they wrestled with noble fatigue. They were tired for good reasons. And when you and I wrestle with noble fatigue, I hope that we will simply lighten up on ourselves. And that we will realize that there are some things that are more important than just finding that our heads are bobbing during a worship service. You see, I think it is so much more significant that we would come here and that we would connect and that we would be part of this community and that we would let God work in us and that we shouldn't find something minor. Like from time to time, I kind of doze off. And if you do, would you please enjoy your nap while you have it? Because there are more important things than that. You see, it is more important for us together to strive to figure out how we will love God with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind. And it is more important for us to find out how we will serve the one who gave his all for us. And as we do that from time to time, due to various forms of fatigue, daily fatigue, noble fatigue, and even self-inflicted fatigue, we may find ourselves nodding off, because the truth is this: that fatigue, faith, and faithfulness will always be twisted together in our lives. And as we have fatigue, we want to grow in our faith and we want to be faithful to our King. And the King says, guys, you're going to do that best if you do it together, as you study my word and as you seek my face. And we will do that despite the fact that fatigue does set in. Father, I thank you for this story, and I thank you that there are things that are more important than fatigue. And I pray to Heavenly Father that we would major on the majors and let the minors be small. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that we would enjoy our time with each other and that we would lighten up on sometimes not someone who just can't keep their eyes open, and may we just call it what it is, something that is very normal. And in the midst of this, Father, may we grow to love you very much. May our faith expand and our faithfulness be more pure. We ask in the name of Jesus, who loves us. Amen.